So hi everyone, welcome to Coding Ninjas. And so as the next episode in this series, like we have Mr. Divyanshu with us. Divyanshu is CTO of one of the fastest growing startups in the wedding industry. This is WedMeGood. And we would love, like, we'll just love to talk to Divyanshu about his journey, like how did he become a CTO at a company like WedMeGood, like which I think is close to 100 people now. And would also love to just like learn from his journey, what all he did, what are the different steps he took in his career, and what sort of advice he will have for all the students out there. So, hi Divyanshu, welcome to Coding Ninjas.
Hey, hi Ankush, thank you for being
here. Yeah, so Divyanshu, before we jump into understanding your whole journey, right? Like before we talk about like a little bit more about WedMeGood, a little bit of your college life as well. And we'd also like to cover like any sort of advice you might have for students out there who are still in college or about to graduate, right? Like, or maybe 1 or 2 years of experience on how to basically sort of like, should they dream of eventually becoming a CTO somewhere? Like if yes, then what is the sort of journey that they can potentially take to get there? So before all of that, would love to just get to understand. I think one very common question is what do you actually do? Like what is a CTO supposed to do? Right? Are you supposed to write code? Are you supposed to just manage people? Right? Like are you like more like a manager of technical people, or you have to write code as well? Right? Like so just would love to understand more on that.
All right, sure. So see, role of a CTO, you know, varies a lot depending on the org to org. Wherever you are working right now, will have a different definition or different expectation that you would have from a CTO, right? So if let's say you're working with a 10-member startup, right? 10-member company startup with a, let's say, 3-4-member dev team, right? And 5 business teams, then you would be coding 70-80% of your time, right? Even 90% of your time. And some of your time will obviously go into management, making sure that everyone has enough tasks on their plate, you know, everyone has enough things to do, right? All the priorities are being picked up and they are being sorted out, right? Now, as the team size grows, you will start to see that there is a management overhead that comes in, because now everyone in the team will have different viewpoints. When you are working small setup, you are probably managing 1 or 2 projects at a time. You might now have 20 projects at the same time, right? So making sure that all the 20 projects are being run simultaneously at different places, right? And all of them have different technical challenges that they do face, right? They would need architectural decisions, they would need database decisions, they would need business support, they would need to interact with other people in the team, right? So all that needs to be done. Now, how do you achieve that is by building out the right set of structure in the team, right? So a very important part of CTO's job is to have that vision that what kind of team I would need, or what kind of team I am, where I am and where do I need to grow and how the team should grow accordingly, right? And that keeps on changing. Every 2-3 years, you will see a major overhaul in team structures, priorities, the way people work, right? You might see people moving from Trello to Jira to something else, right? That all depends on the team size and business size, obviously, right? That is one critical part, that building out the team and making sure that how everyone in the team is also motivated enough towards the problem solving, right? And every developer might have his own sort of need, right? Some people want to work a lot on the code problem. Some people are excited about solving business problems, right? So making sure everyone has the separate, you know, the kind of work they want in their hands, right? Then an important part of the CTO's job is to interact stakeholder management, interacting with people, interacting with business, understanding how the business is growing, where is it growing, how can tech be an enabler or a driver in business, how can tech support the business, right? So figuring out those things, right? So that's also a very important and critical part of it, right? So on a day-to-day life, you know, a CTO will probably start with a daily call with the leads of the engineering team, right? And understand where we are in all the projects, what is moving forward, is there a bottleneck somewhere, do you need, how do you resolve it, right? Kaha kaun phasa hua hai, different kind of problems that they see, right? Then obviously go and then obviously you had tens of meetings because you are interacting with n amount of people inside the team as well as outside vendors also, right? Because any application you see these days won't just have in-house code. It will also need number of external API integrations, vendor integrations and all that. So those integrations, those interactions keep on happening, right? then you would obviously, you would probably want to sit with architects in the team, you sit with EMs in the team, and you know, plan out for the next set of next, what is next week goal, what is the next 6 months goal. And it keeps on changing. Everything is to prioritize, your prioritization happens. Some critical business needs have come in. How do we make sure that we take it there, right? And then you also keep on planning how to evolve your architectures, how to evolve your system, how the tech should evolve to take care of the growing business, right? A business which was probably a 10 CR annual revenue business, now it's going to 100 CR business. Now, how do I take care of that 10x growth? How will the tech be able to manage that or not, right? So yeah, this is a lot of things, people management, ensuring everyone has the right set of career path and career goals. This is also a critical part of it, right? So you need to plan out their careers. If someone joins you as a SD in the team, or let's say as an intern in the team, how does he grow from intern to SD to SD1 to manager, probably a CTO, VP engineering, that kind of roles, right? So that career path is very important to carve out.
Right.
So I would say these are the things that, you know, CTO keeps on doing every day. You keep on struggling with it every day. You need to figure out, okay, this is what I thought last week, but now it's not applicable all of a sudden, right? So again, go back to the drawing board and keep coming with new ideas.
Right. So do you miss writing code? Do you sometimes miss like that you don't really get time to do that?
Yeah, I do that. I think when I transitioned into a CTO role at Better, right? I think that was the first CTO role for me in a separate organization. Obviously, I had a startup before that, so that was different. But yeah, as a proper organization, that was the first CTO role for me, right? When we started, I built initial frameworks. I built entire systems. But as we started moving out, my role started becoming more and more diverse, right? So I could hardly find time to code. I was able to do probably 30-40% of coding there compared to what I was doing in the earlier days, right? And that has started to reduce a lot. Now, it initially was quite weird, you know, as a developer, you feel like, you know, I am the only one who actually knows the best coding, right? So you feel like I want to code everything out of it. And then you realize you can't really do that because there are 20 projects at the same time.
Right.
You can only probably work on one project at the same time, right? So it's about understanding that when do you need to get into the code? When do you need to get out of the code, right? So having that view is very important. You need to keep on shifting your scope from, you know, problems. कि आप कभी आप ग्राउंड लेवल पे काम करो, कभी आप 10,000 फीट पे काम कर रहे होगे, तो आपको वो मैनेज करना पड़ेगा. दैट्स अ वेरी क्रूशियल पार्ट ऑफ डे टू डे पार्ट ऑफ द सीटीओज रोल, राइट? कोडिंग ऑब्वियसली मिस इट. आई थिंक आई डू वेरी लेस कोडिंग नाउ, मोस्टली प्रोबब्ली सम स्क्रिप्ट्स और समथिंग समवेयर, प्रोबब्ली अ स्मॉल पैच, आई नो, इफ आई हैव सम फ्री टाइम इन द डे. बट या, यू डू मिस इट बिकॉज़ यू स्टार्ट एज अ प्रोग्रामर व्हेन यू स्टार्ट मूविंग टू मैनेजमेंट. सो या,
राइट. Right. So, and one thing that, for example, right, like, so I think like one thing that you mentioned in this, I think one major part of your job seems to be hiring people and managing them really well and like managing their career, right? Like, so when you're hiring people generally at a startup, right, like, and maybe specifically about you, like, what sort of skill set you look for in these people? And that skill set can be technical as well as non-technical skill set, right? Like, what sort of people do you love to work with, and do you like to get on your team?
So one critical thing I would say, like what I look at when I'm hiring people is, are they comfortable with ownership, right? So a lot of developers you talk to, they would say, you know, if I had some seniors to guide me, it would be really great for me to work here. As a startup, you never have the luxury of hiring too many people, right? You will always have small teams. You will always be, you know, one person is handling 10 different projects, right? So that needs a different kind of mindset. So technical skills are one part of evaluation that keeps on happening. You know, you look at, yeah, you know, data structures, algorithms, the language you want to code on, database, SQL queries. But these are basic things that you expect a developer to know, right? That pretty much has become the standard of the industry. But another part is the attitude towards what kind of problems they are looking to solve. If they are purist developers who only want to solve core technical problems, right? But as an organization, it is not going to happen that you always have core problems to solve. Right? Hundreds of, in fact, if you look at probably in 1 year, organization will have two or three very critical core projects. Rest of the year would be a bug fixing or maintenance or building an API here and there, right? And that's how every organization has that in the world, right? And the developer needs to understand that if that mindset is not there, that becomes a problem post hiring, right? Because then he would be always unhappy because I'm not getting new work. coming back to you. Meko naya acha kaam karu. Acha kaam. You know, you need to figure out what is the next big task I can give him, right? And that's a very important part of it, right? And the people who are more driven towards taking ownership of the project. So if you give them a product, let's say you are building a video editor, right? Now it has n number of components, and someone who wants to figure that everything out and get into the code, understand how does it work, and track with n number of people. There are multiple stakeholders in every project, right? You have business people, you have analytics team, data team, product team. Then you have a lot of people to interact with, architects to interact with. Now, those are the developers who actually grow quite fast and quite well in their careers. And those are the kind of people I generally like to work with.
So I totally agree on that, right? Like, so like being more output driven rather than the input driven, right? Like sort of like, even if you're not enjoying what you are today doing, but like, you know that this is going to impact heavily your customers, your business, right? Like, and that is something that should drive you towards that work. So totally agree on that. So that sounds great. So now let's go a little back, right? Like, let's go to your college now. So I think you went to college 2008 to 2012. So let's just rewind up very, very quickly. So you were in computer science department or like some other department?
No, I was in electrical and electronics.
Okay.
So
and you were in BITS Goa, right?
Yeah. BITS Goa campus.
That's extremely lucky, man. Like, I'm so jealous. Like, you went to college in Goa. I think my parents would not have, like, they would have said that, let's go to your college, dhoond lete hain, thoda sa kharab bhi hoga chalega, Goa nahi bhejenge. Like, what was the thought process? Like, how did you like ended up at BITS Goa?
Yeah, I think there was no plan. So what I think when you give the BITSAT exam, right, you get certain marks, and you have to fill in your preferences that of what stream do you want in what campus,
right?
And then we filled out the stream, obviously Tripoli and computer science are the top two streams. VBA, it always is pretty much, right? So I started filling it out. My dad was like, "You go in Tripoli." I was like, "Okay." Let's fill out Tripoli. They filled out Tripoli in three campuses. They filled out computer science in three campuses, and I got like computer science in BITS Goa, Tripoli in BITS Goa. Like, I was like, okay, it was a new campus, right? Potentially pollution free, nice place, right? I think we were the third or fourth batch. We were the third or fourth batch of the campus. So a couple of good things. Obviously, the tagging culture was not there. So a lot of colleges have parents have a fear that my kid will go there and the senior will start ragging him, right? So like a new college, no culture has developed, not handling our problems, right? And decent branch. Like, all right, so let's go there. And I think and then we got admitted there. Nothing as planned, but yeah. You got that was the best option, I think, at that time.
Okay. Yeah. And when did you sort of like got into programming? When did you start like sort of realizing that I want to be in computer science? I want to write code rather than like go into a core electronics sort of a role?
So I think I started programming in 11th, right? Mm-hmm. I think 11th standard, we had computer science subject. There was a book, was there, C++. Sumita Arora's book was there. It's quite popular, I think. It was in every school they teach that book.
Right.
So I started programming with that, right? Shuru mein, it was not really interesting. What is this? Like, random alien language. What is this? What is happening? You add A plus B equal to 2. Why do I need to write that big of a code to simply calculate sum of two numbers? And so that's how I started. I think then we had to submit a project. So that was the time when I actually got hooked into programming. So because I was building the project that I took was hospital management system. Right? And then I realized that, okay, now this programming thing makes a lot of sense because now you're actually solving some problems. Right? You could build a software that can set to companies. And that was interesting for me. So when I built that module, I built entire systems. And then that is how I actually got into programming. And somehow I kept loving, I loved that. I loved doing programming. I think by the end of 12th, I was doing quite well in programming. Right? I wanted to go for computer science, but obviously, you know, yeah, at that age, you don't really have a lot of control on what you want to do. You go and do triple E. I think that's the story of pretty much everyone
sad, in the country. That's extreme, right? Honestly, that's extremely sad that how many of us have similar stories, right? Like, so for example, in my case, I wanted to apply computer science and I sort of said that, oh, okay, I have a decent rank in IIT JEE. Now, I'll first fill IIT Delhi, Bombay, Kanpur, like I'll pull CS at all the places. And he was like, no, no, first IIT Delhi CS, bharo, fir IIT Delhi Electronics, bharo, fir IIT Delhi Mechanical, bharo, fir baki bharo. Like, you can't go outside Delhi. Now, what branch you get, that's okay. it's pretty sad that how many of us have similar stories on this.
True. And till 12th, you obviously know everything. Physics is also quite simple. Math, everything is quite simple. So electronics, you also want to, okay, we'll do that. I went there and I realized that shit, I don't enjoy it. I'm not enjoying this. it's just not something I want to do. Right. So I was doing two things in college then. One was programming. I started learning programming. And I think was playing cricket. So we had a college cricket team. I was like, nice, we'll play cricket. And the evening we'll play cricket. The whole day I'm sitting doing some random coding stuff. In fact, I don't think after first year, few months, I even went to classes. Not a good advice to students, but yeah.
No, I think like if you are not going to classes and you're writing code, I think that's an absolutely good advice. Right? Like don't go out and like hang out in malls or like
trips, right? That makes sense.
Yeah, but like at least if you're writing code, I think that's much better use of time rather than sitting in classes. anyways, yeah. So perfect. So seems like you got into Triple E, like you were enjoying to write code. Like, what was your first job like? And so would love to understand that.
Yeah, so I think I started in Bangalore, right? This Alpha Beta Labs. Right? When I joined them, so I hadn't done a lot of professional programming. I was doing a lot of programming in 4 years. I did a lot of coding and all, right? But there's a different sort of expectation when you are actually working outside, you know, and working for a firm, because then you have deadlines coming in. That was the first time I had deadlines. Before that, I was like, okay, let's build a website, you know, at any time, any point of time. But now you have deadlines and client expectations to be met, right? So when I was working with them, I built three projects. One was a cancer life. That was a social network for cancer patients. One was an art renting platform. And another was a DJ auction, art auction and DJ renting platform. So you could hire a DJ. So these three systems I built. The good thing was that when I built the entire system, so I had the entire ownership, which is something I actually like, because you get to know what the exact business problem was that needs to be solved. You build structures, everything you need to decide by yourself and get everything stashed to end. I was building, right? So that was a great experience for me. I actually loved it, and that shaped a lot in terms of how my career moved forward. I was able to learn a lot of things with very tight deadlines. I think those were days when there was nothing else to do. Also, I was always coding. I used to, I think, reach office by 9 or something and leave by 12, 1 p.m. in an a.m. in the night, right? I had a bike, so easy to commute. Not easy to commute if you're traveling by bus at midnight. I loved the way we are solving problems. And we are very highly focused on the code quality and making sure that the right set of code is being written by the developers and everyone. Right? So it was great. Working there was great for me.
Right. And how did you get your like first job? Like, and how did you decide to join this one rather than something else? Like, what was that process like?
I think I connected with them. So the founder was a senior of mine in the same college.
Okay.
I connected with him through some friend, right? And he said, but you know, just talk to him. He started a startup. And for me, I think the fourth year when we were interviewing, so either you have a campus placement, which was not possible because campus placement would be the same branch that you have. So if you're in Triple E, you get campus placement in Triple E. So that was anyways out of the question, right? So now I thought, okay, what are the next thing I should do? Should I apply for big companies or should I go for, you know, small startups? Like, So I talked to a lot of friends, seniors, people who are already in the industry. So what I gathered, and I think it's pretty much true for everywhere, that if you go for a big organization, you get a module to develop, probably a small module or a small piece to work on, and you will keep on working on that for probably a few months or a few years. Right? But if you go for a startup, it is tough because you have a lot of instability. You don't know when the company can shut down. A lot of things can happen. But you get to learn a lot of things. You could build products and projects from scratch, which is a great thing. You learn the entire life cycle of the project. Right? So so if let's say a software developer in a big organization, what he would learn in 2, 3, 4 years of his time there, you would probably learn in 6 months in a startup. Right? And that's what leads to accelerated growth in your career.
Right.
So that's how I made a decision. No, I will go for a startup. And then I started interacting with different people who were known or who were launching startups. What is happening in the industry? Right? So I met with these guys. It made sense, that I could join them. And I thought, okay, it makes sense. Let's go ahead with this and I joined them basically. Had a couple of interviews with them, rounds, and then yes, okay, it makes sense. You join us, I join you. And yeah, that's how that decision happened, whether it's a big company or startups.
Yeah. Okay. Perfect. And did you start a company yourself as well in the, after Alpha Beta Labs and before Bitby Good, somewhere in the middle?
Yeah. 2014. Mid of 2014, August or September, I started a company. So the problem what I was trying to solve, what happened that, I used to play for a college team in Goa, right? A friend of mine who was at that time in Oracle, he was also a big cricket fan, right? We were both good friends in college. So we started talking, discussing ideas, catch a drive, what is happening, startup, a lot of ideas are coming out. What can we do? What can we build? Right? So a problem that we picked up was the visibility of people or cricketers at a club or a grassroots level, because there is no platform for them. Even today, if you look at it, you probably find Ranji cricketer stats on Cricinfo or anywhere, but you would not find stats of a club cricketer anywhere. There is no platform for them to showcase how good they are playing, how well they are playing, how many matches scores they have, what average they have. Right? So we decided to build a social platform, a LinkedIn sort of portfolio for them. Right? So we thought it will work. It did not somehow. But yeah, we were quite excited. This is the problem we want to solve. Right? And then we both left our jobs. Right? We started this thing. So we started building it out. I think that we built the entire product. Everything was built. And then we had some funds. We started building it. So we built it. Over a period of 3-4 months, we built a product. 6 months, sort of, it was pretty much finalized. Everything was running, up and running. Everything was working. We saw good traffic, decent amount of traffic coming in. Somehow it did not click, use case as a business. So where we failed was, we were good tech guys. We knew how to build products. We could build entire company, could be anything you could give us, any task, any sort of complex systems, we could build it. But we did not know how to build a business. I think that is where we sort of failed. What are the business use case for this? And then the research that we showed initially, we did it later when we thought now it's not working. So we failed at the startup. We ran for a year. We pretty much shut it down. But we learned a lot of things. We learned what is the right use case. How do you find the right use case? Right? And what is the business problem you are trying to solve? And that shaped a lot for me. After that, it has shaped a lot in terms of how I have started thinking about business. How I think about tech. How I think about the companies that you're working or joining at. So yeah, that was interesting, great time for us. We enjoyed it a lot. We built a lot of things. We built a lot of things, live streaming. I think there were times when I was learning technology. We both were learning technology in the entire one day and building prototype the next day. So amazing times. I think I learned Node in a few hours. We built an entire backend server in Node. Shit. We had no idea.
Absolutely, man. So can totally relate to that, right? And I think that is one mistake a lot of first-time founders, including myself, make and made is, "Ye mera best friend hai, ye mere college ka dost hai, aur iske saath start karte hai." And that is absolutely fine. But the problem is that person is exactly like the other founder, yeah. right? Like as in, exactly. उसको भी tech बहुत अच्छा आता है, मुझे भी tech बहुत अच्छा आता है, कर लेंगे. And like we don't understand that like to actually build a business, you need people with different type of skill set, right? Like for example, in my case, like I actually got a co-founder 2 years after sort of starting the company as well, when I sort of knew that. यार अब बिजनेस को अगर स्केल करना है तो देन आई नीड somebody who has sort of like that sort of skill set as well, right? Like so yeah, so absolutely can totally relate to you and like totally makes sense. So how long did you spend on that? How much time did you spend on that?
We spent a year on that, right? But we knew after 8-9 months we knew ki this is not working out. We tried a lot of new things. We even tried to sell some of it, get softwares, build systems. But we knew after 8-9 months okay, that this is not a business problem. This is a problem that you know you could do in your hobby. As a hobby, you can build this thing, but you probably won't make a big use case, right? So we did it for a year.
Right. September. And then why did you like sort of continue with it? Like do something else with your new knowledge, like sort of like the business acumen that you had now, right? Like, so why did you decide to like, did you start something else or like, did you move into a company?
No, I did not start. One, obviously, we were out of cash, so we didn't have any money. So it's like, you want to start a new company with no money, how does that work?
And third,
okay, no, you know, so we know we have failed. This has gone down, but I don't think this is not the end of the world, right?
Absolutely. Yeah.
So I think I met then Better Butters, right? Founders, we clicked it. I like the idea, you know. We somehow, what the good thing was, they were from the business side. So I like the idea. You guys can take over the business. So I take care of the tech, which is I am really good at. I will do that. You go and build the right business around this. So yeah, I think it was a decision that you know we thought, okay, let's move to jobs, and then obviously you also need the idea to think. If you're building a company, starting a company, you have to be really passionate about the idea. Otherwise, you know, you won't really put your best on it, and then it will anyways die out.
So
I think we haven't found any strong use case after that in which you could start a business.
Sure.
Yeah, both of us are still in touch. We stay close. She's quite close to me actually. In the same society, we stay in the same society actually. You know. So yeah, let's see if something comes up.
So which company did you join? Like you mentioned the name, but I couldn't get it. Like which company did you join post this?
I joined Better Butter.
Okay.
Better Butter.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. Perfect. Right. So, So I think like one thing that I would like to highlight here, right? Like I tell a lot of my students that, you know, अंदर से feel आनी चाहिए कि कुछ भी दे दो, बना तो मैं दूँगा, right? Like that feel, that confidence once you get from inside, like then you sort of have reached a place that you are now extremely good in tech. That is not the problem anymore, and like you will never be worried about. कि यार जॉब नहीं मिलेगी तो क्या होगा राइट लाइक दैट द सॉर्ट ऑफ कंसर्न्स दैट कंप्लीटली गो अवे व्हिच अलाउज यू टू टेक रिस्क लाइक सेइंग कि यार चलो स्टार्ट करके देखते हैं नहीं भी होगा कुछ तो कुछ नहीं होगा क्या फर्क पड़ता है लाइक मेरे को नहीं मिलेगी जॉब तो किसको मिलेगी राइट लाइक दैट सॉर्ट ऑफ कॉन्फिडेंस ऑटोमेटिकली कम्स इन वंस यू से दैट आई कैन बिल्ड व्हाटएवर आई वांट टू बिल्ड राइट सो या डेफिनेटली आई थिंक समथिंग दैट मेक्स अ लॉट ऑफ सेंस परफेक्ट सो यू जॉइंड बेटर बटर एंड लाइक यू आर you were sort of handling the whole tech there, right? So, how many years did you spend there?
I spent 3 years. I spent 3 years at Better Butter, right? Mm-hmm. I think I joined them. 2015 August, and I joined them. Right? I joined them as CTO. They had just launched. The product was hardly a month old. Initially, it was built by some firm. I don't even remember the name now. I don't have the name of the firm now. But yeah, it was an initial structure that they had built. The systems were not really well built. They hardly launched.
Yeah.
And the idea was to build an in-house team. They're looking for a CTO. So I talked to them. You know, we clicked it. So good thing. Great interaction. We are still very good friends, all three of us. Right. We built it. Better Butter was basically a recipe discovery platform. The idea was you could create recipes in various languages, in various formats, and you could search and discover different recipes based on search keywords or what you have in your fridge. You could just ask, you know, just tell me ki aapka, if you have palak and let's say mutter in your fridge, what could I make out of it? So you could just search two ingredients and you could get a list of recipes that you could make, right? Interesting product. We built it initially. I built initial MVPs, got a couple of interns. So it was a typical startup journey. You have to say, you know, you start small. You start with a small team, and then as your product keeps on picking up pace, as it starts growing, then you start growing your team also accordingly. Like, and that whole transition from 100% time coding to 50-60% time coding went right. So I think so. We're there for 3 years. We built a product, did really well. We raised I think a couple of $2 million overall there. Then it was acquired by Silverpush, yeah, in 2018 end, right?
Okay.
And so yeah, great time. We had probably one of the best times, right? At Betterwater. Yeah.
Okay.
We had a
meaning, man. So I just love the fact, right? Like the fact that you decided to, let's say, not go for a company like a large company, right? And instead of go for a startup, and like within 2 years you had the confidence to start something on your own. Then within 3 years you were sort of like a CTO at a company which is growing pretty quickly, right? Like, so completely set you apart in terms of your journey. So would love to just sort of step back and like ask you a few questions around what would be your suggestion to students, right? Like, so anybody who is in college right now, what sort of skill set they should try to build? What should they try to achieve while they're in college? Right. And like, so yeah, let's first take that. So what would be your advice to like what they should do while they're in college?
So obviously, one is obviously since we're talking about tech, programming, coding kind of environment. If you're interested in programming, that you have to be. Otherwise, most of my suggestions won't be relevant. So if you're interested in programming, I would say, you know, there's a very important part of programming is your algorithms and data structures, which we typically ignore because we really think that there's no impact in real world, right? Which is actually quite wrong. And I also used to think that when we were being taught this QoS tags, binary data, like where do I need these things, right? And then I realized that it's actually quite useful, right? So when you start, the idea is to become good at programming. You code a lot. I think at that, in college, you don't need to know about kya ho raha hai, kya nahi ho raha hai. You need to code a lot. Once you have built and coded a lot of things, then you should start shaping your thought around product. That, okay, for example, you are building, let's say, a number of programs can be built. Fibonacci series is there, or let's say you're building a red flag tree, which would be you're building a number of things, right? And those are just programming, core programming problem that you're solving, right? Now you should start thinking towards what is the actual use case of it? How does it impact a user? And when you start to move from core programming and you start thinking like, how does it impact the user? That is a very fundamental shift in shaping one's career, I would say. Right? If you see, every organization has people who are in ICs, who are architects, really good architects, who build really complex, highly complex systems. Right? Then you have people who are engineering managers, who are CTOs, who are VP of engineering. These are people who won't be very good in architectures. They won't be able to probably architect an Amazon type of complex system, right? But they know how can I use my current system? How can I use my team to solve a business problem and solve a user's problem, right? So these are very two sort of fundamentally different paths, I would say, right? One is hard-coded towards tech problems, solving complex business problems. And then one is hard-coded towards solving business problems, right? And both the directions are completely fine. You can take any one of them and you can succeed in any one of them, right? And if you do that, either you go very deep into tech, you become really good, or you move towards the product side. The demand for people who are on more inclined with product trend is quite high, right? Because every startup, every company these days, they need people who can relate to user problems and who can solve user problems, right? This is a very critical and important thing that you know, whoever is starting programming, who wants to have a career in programming, they should know about this, right? You could obviously learning programming is, I would say, very easy part of it. Actually, coding is quite an easy part of it. The idea is to understand the user problem and to be able to figure out an approach to solve it. Right? Code to aap kar loge. If you have been doing programming for 2-3 years, you will be able to, you know, code it. And that, I think, that is the least worrisome skill, I would say. Obviously, right. You need to know how to code, but yeah, but to know how to solve the user problem is the very core and critical thing.
Right. And how does somebody decide like what sort of companies to join, right? Like, let's say like a fresh graduate has an offer from, let's say, an Amazon, and a really like a 5-people team, a startup which is like has promising people, maybe has some funding as well. Like how does somebody decide like what to do on basis of what sort of decisions, right? Like what sort of factors?
So let's talk about your friends, right? If you go for an MNC, what do you get? You get a great job security, right? You would work with, obviously you work with smart people. They also have smart people there. You would work with smart people there. You will be solving some part of the problem, right? You will be getting a good salary, on time salary. There is no problem as such. You are secured for life, right? That's a good way to, you know, start. On the other hand, you have startups. You have a lot of problems. Being in a startup, you always worried about next round of funding. If that doesn't come in, the company can shut down, right? There is a lot of instability. There is a lot of chaos. A startup, you will never have a set of fixed requirement. You will see that things are changing every day. You know, prioritization happens every day. You'll be like, you know, can I get some piece that, you know, give me this problem? I want to solve this problem. But you will never get that in the startup, right? So the path to startup is very difficult, I would say, right? As a person, you need to know that if you, and that's a choice that you have to take, and that's a very big decision to take. It's not something you should take lightly, because you could see that after a year or two, people struggle a lot and then start to move back. They want to move back to the bigger organizations. Then they again face problems, because now they are used to this kind of work culture. They go to that kind of work culture. Adjustment is the problem, right? So if you are willing to learn a lot, if you want to learn a lot, right, but you are not looking for a work-life balance, you're looking for a very long hours, you're looking for very hard problems to solve, you should join a startup, right? It has its perils, but it also has its benefits, right? The problem is that out of 50%, 60%, 100% people, probably only 40-50% of people will actually get into good startups. Even within the startups, you have issues, right? Some are small companies, some are not really good organizations, right? So problems are there also. It's all about what your mindset is, what kind of challenge you are looking for in your life, right? You could easily settle for in a big organization, and there's nothing wrong with that. It's a very good and, you know, tried and tested path. Startup, absolutely, again, a lot of risk, and probably, you know, the weirdest part, you know, something. I think there's a poem, no? The road less taken. So yeah, so there's a road which is less taken. So you should not. It's very scary. It is difficult. If you're doing your own startup, then it's far more difficult. I mean, you will be through failures when you won't have any money, and you were like, well, what am I doing with the life, right? So it's difficult, but it's also very fulfilling. So that's very, you know, once you solve those problems, you realize that you have learned a lot compared to your peers or compared to your batchmates who are in different organizations. You could sit with them and talk on hundreds of things, right? While they would look and only come back and tell you that I worked on this. So this is the only thing I did for 2 years, and you feel like I built these new things, right? I built entire architecture systems. So, yeah.
Right. Absolutely. That's, I think, really good advice, and like something that I totally and completely agree with. And thanks a lot, Divyanshu. I think this was really insightful. I'm sure a lot of people would really enjoy this. And thanks a lot for taking out time. And I personally really enjoyed talking to you. And thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having me here.
For new programming updates and videos, subscribe to Coding Ninjas channel.